Good morning, church family. How are we all doing today? All righty. Hey, you guys want to stand with us and we'll open up this service in some worship and praise? In my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. You are my lighthouse, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Fire before us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Hey! Fire before us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. It's time to rise and shine. So welcome to Anchor of Hope Church. We're so glad you're here. Today, unbeknownst to me, but knowns to her, our dear sister Jody is visiting us today.
Yeah.
So join me in welcoming her, because I have missed her smiling face these many months, and I don't know about you, but her smile just brightens my day, as does yours. So, today I have a couple of announcements. First of all, I'm not Carla, and Carla has been doing an amazing job of doing announcements, and I'm so grateful for her help with the bulletin and then also presenting these different activities and things to you. Today, that's my privilege to get to share this. So just drawing your attention to the bulletin this week. On Thursday, we are launching our men's Bible study on Thursday mornings at 6:15. And I don't know what we're going to be studying yet, but it's going to be fun. And it's going to have coffee and other refreshments of that nature for morning time Bible study gatherings. That'll be followed by a prayer meeting, as usual, around 9 o'clock on Thursday. And then also, Thursday's a big day, y'all, for real. We're having a council meeting. So if you're new to Anchor of Hope or you've been here for a while and you've heard this word council thrown around a little bit, essentially, the church council, it's our church leadership. And we have, for our church, we have two main bodies. We have the Pastor Parish Relations Committee. They serve as like an advisory board to me as the pastor. And then we also have the Council of Administration, where they make sure the business of the church happens, making sure that ministry continues forward. And so this Thursday, the plan, assuming none of us get sick and fall ill, the plan is that on Thursday evening at 6:30, we're going to be meeting as the Council of Administration. Now, here's the really cool thing. Even though those who are official members of the board or the council, they're allowed to vote on different action items and things that get decided, you are more than welcome to come and hear what's going on in the church.
And give input.
And give input in due order, but you're welcome. It's always any time that that invitation gets thrown out there and then somebody who's new shows up, there's kind of this awkward little moment. Don't worry about that because I would love for all of us to be engaged and participating in these discussions. Because as we go forward as a church, it's really important for you to be informed and for us to be informed about, you know, how other people think other than this guy. So that being said, if you're interested, please show up. We'd love to have you. There will not be food at that meeting, unfortunately. So come fed, but we'll be doing that. Coming up, this week and the next couple of weeks are going to be a lot of things rolling out as we get into the fall season. And so next Sunday, we're going to be doing a few things. Number one, it's potluck Sunday next week. Yay! There should always be food. And because there should always be food, we have signups in the lobby. And so if you're interested in contributing to the potluck, then you are welcome to sign up for one of those things on the list. I think there's three categories. And so whatever the Lord prompts you to share, write it down so we know that we're not just having a dessert luncheon. So, yes, Andy.
Is that going to be here?
It'll be here, yep. We had the special privilege of getting to open up our house this summer for summer barbecues. And since we're not barbecuing, we're going to just be here and we're going to enjoy the facilities. So there you go. So signups are down there. We're also, next Sunday, the plan, barring whatever your response to my next question is going to be, the plan is to get started with a Sunday morning adult Bible study. Last year, we really started rolling out what I like to call anchored communities because of the name, but also because they're small groups, essentially, that meet some other time than this hour to hour and a half on a Sunday morning. And so one of those that I'd like us to get to offering is some kind of a Bible study that doesn't meet on a different day or a different, I guess, time frame of the week, but is all inclusive to you coming to church on a Sunday. And so the plan would be for us to have a Bible study that meets from 9:30 to 10:30 on Sunday mornings and would kind of follow the similar educational structure as the kids ministry downstairs, as far as like when certain things happen. But the question that I have for you is, show of hands, how many of you would be interested in attending an adult Bible study on Sunday mornings? It'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall, I believe. Okay. All right. Very good. So with that in mind, that's going to be led by Ron McCrary, and he's going to put together some kind of introductory thing for next week. So all of you who just raised your hands, if you don't have plans next Sunday, show up at 9:30 and it'll be fun. So that being said, also coming up the third week of September, we have the ladies sew group that's going to be at Angie's in my place on Mondays from 6:30 to 7:30 in the evening. And so for more information, talk to Angie about that. We're putting a pause on home fellowship at the moment. We're still figuring some of those details out. Also on the 19th, so that's the day after the SO group starts to meet, we're going to be launching a youth group here at the church, something that's not in direct partnership with Crossroad, who we partner with for the kids and youth for their midweek program on Wednesdays. We're going to be starting a Tuesday youth group specifically for middle school and eventually high schoolers as the Lord provides. Whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop. That's right. So you ladies need to be inviting all your friends. And they're not even paying attention. It's cool.
Maggie, Lily.
It's all good.
Hey. We're talking about you.
Hey.
Yeah.
Both of you. Yeah. Oh, hey. Huzzah. Anyway, that being said, there is a lot that's going on and is planned for the autumn season. And I'm excited for us all to engage with that together. So if you have any further questions or comments or questions or concerns and or violent disagreements, you're welcome to email me or call me or text me. If it's a violent disagreement, let's make sure we meet in person so I can at least look you in the eye and see your face, because I love you and I hope you love me too. So that being said, final thing. See, this is what happens when they make me in charge of announcements. We have these Connect cards. They should be in the pew in front of you. If this is your first time here, or you would like to connect more beyond this moment and beyond our anchored communities that we're launching this fall, please feel free to fill that out. We're not going to share your information with anybody. That's just an in-house thing. Also, if you have a prayer concern, whether that's for yourself, a family member, or somebody that you're connected to, that's a way to share that prayer request, and we pray for those on Thursday mornings when they get put into the offering. So there's a box on the back wall there that you can slip that into, and there you have it. So that's all that I need to say right now, and with that in mind, let's pray and continue in worship. Angie, would you pray?
Heavenly Father, thank you for this privilege and honor to be with you and to do it together. That is what makes our faith unique, is that we do it together with you, and that you are in community with yourself. And as part of, as image bearers, we worship with each other in community. And it's, God, thank you that you have put us in families and that you have put us in this family. So God, we come to you as one united family, united under you today. And we offer you our whole selves, we offer you our hearts, and we want you to be blessed this morning. Amen.
grace, what have you done? Murdered for me on that cross, accused in the absence of wrong, my sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. The scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, to give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope. Mercy, my heart now to see. The day and its troubles shall come. I know that your strength is enough. The scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be alive. Know to be alive.
And the moments and the generations to come, you are the God who never fails. Amen. You may have a seat.
Good morning again, everybody. It is good and strange to be back in this place, in this moment, doing this thing on a Sunday morning. I've been on vacation, with the exception of the last couple of weeks, getting reacclimated to my schedule a little bit, but I've been out of the pulpit, so to speak, since 4 weeks ago. And so I am very glad to be able to open the Word with you today, because, man, on my vacation, I got to catch a glimpse of where God's going to be taking us in the letter to 2 Corinthians. For the next 5 weeks, including today. And so I'm excited to get that started. Before I do, because it was my job to do announcements and I missed one, so starting next week, in addition to the adult Bible study, we're also launching our kids' church experience again. What that means, though, is we need volunteers to help guide the children through the material. And so there is a sign up. It's a bright yellow sheet. You can't miss it, on the table in the lobby. If you're interested in helping with Kids Church, this is not a Lone Ranger operation. This is a team effort. And so just by signing up doesn't mean that you're going to be left all alone. But what it does mean is that we can start forming teams so that each week we can make sure that it's covered for our kids' church. It's been good to be able to give our volunteers the month of August off and these first couple of weeks of September. But starting next week, it's going to be back in the saddle again. And so if you're interested, even if you have any kind of inclination, I'm looking at you, VBS volunteers, because you're already vetted and you're exposed to my kids and Hope and other kids. And so if you're interested, if you have any inclination towards that, please think about signing up. Can't stress that enough, because although I'm very grateful for the investment that a few people did this last year, I'd like to expand so that it doesn't fall just all on their shoulders. So please sign up if you are so inclined. So it officially starts next Sunday. So the kids' church thing it's during church. It's after the first song, we release the kids to go sing songs and learn about Jesus and age-appropriate curriculum and that kind of thing. And we have it all together, and you will be equipped to be able to do that and to win in that area of ministry. So there you go. That was my last announcement for sure. Let's go ahead and pray again, and then we'll get into the time for today with the Word. Father, we thank you. We thank you for worship. We thank you for times like these where we get to experience you together. We thank you for the family of faith that we belong to, whether we officially call this our church home or not. God, because of our faith in you, Jesus, we have brothers and sisters that we can link arms with and we can gather together. And like you told your disciples, where two or more are gathered in my name, I am there. And God, we know that you have met us here so far today. We're so looking forward to what you have to say through the scriptures, through my words that you're going to piece together somehow to make sense of what Paul's talking about and all of that. God, we dedicate this time to you. We want to hear your voice today. We want to open ourselves up to your wisdom for our life. Holy Spirit, even if it's challenging to us, God, we pray that you would help us remain open to receive what you have to say. Jesus, continue to keep our eyes on you as the author and perfecter of our faith. God, like that song says, oh, to be like you. I'd give all I have just to know you. Because Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. And God, we declare that today. We believe that today. We believe that over the lives of our family who's not here today because of illness or travel or one thing or another, God. And we commit them to your hands because, God, we know that you are good and you are loving and you are faithful. And so, God, be with us in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, today we're continuing in our series in 2 Corinthians. You can go to the next slide. We've been on this journey for a while now, and thanks to the help of Rob Griffiths, as well as my friend Stefan, who came from Portland, we've rounded out the first 7 chapters of the book. We are over halfway there, living on more than just a prayer. We made that section. And so that's my corny joke. That's for free. There you go. Love you guys. So summer of you, our very first week, I gave just a general outline of the book. It's not unique to me. I totally stole it from one of my resources and I'm giving it to you. And so you can divide the book into 3 or 4 portions, depending on which commentator you look at. The one that I looked at for this series divided it into 3, and 3 is better than 4 because it's more simple to think about. And so the first 7 chapters create the first main big chunk of what we've covered. And the predominant theme is and has been reconciliation, both between us and the Lord, but also specifically what Paul was referencing was kind of brokering and engaging in a reconciliation between himself and the church that he was writing to. Because there was just some bad stuff going on. There was bad feelings, hurt feelings, bad blood, all of that. And so all of the content that he brought up and has covered and that we've covered together has to do with reconciliation. The next 2 chapters, which is going to be, this is what I'm so excited for in this season, is that it's going to be talking about the distribution. We'll get into more of that in a moment. And also a vindication or vindicating Paul's ministry. And we're going to see what that all has to do with you and me today. Now, focusing on the distribution in chapters 8 and 9, of the second letter to the Corinthians. This is what happened in the early church is that they shared all things in common with one another. You can go to the next slide. Oh, no, pause, parentheses. I swear I'm going to be more on a linear track in just a moment. Next slide, over. That's good. So, Paul, in all of his travels, he did this series of missionary journeys. And what started in Jerusalem, which is in the lower part of the screen there, eventually, with the help of Paul and his team, it spread through all of those areas in a matter of, 20 years or so? Which for back then, considering that was most of the known world to the Roman Empire, that's pretty significant that there were these key cities that Paul and his team would go to and would raise up a church, make sure everything was good and organized, and then they'd go on to the next town. And so what we've been talking about is there's this region called Achaia, and up above it is Macedonia, and in between, somewhere in there, in like, this is an isthmus, whatever, in this one little area, that's where Corinth was right before you get into the region of Achaia. So from for Paul, when he's writing this letter, he is on his third missionary journey. He's now going from what scholars call Asia Minor in the town of Ephesus, and he's making his way up into Macedonia, and he's been in Macedonia for a little bit. And with today, what he's doing is he's reporting on the Macedonian churches and how the testimony of what Corinth has gone through and their testimony as a body of believers, how that has encouraged the Macedonian church. And so today, you can go back a slide, I think. Yes. The title for today's message is The Grace of Giving. The Grace of Giving. And our passage today is going to be 2 Corinthians 8, verses 1 through 7. And the big idea that we're going to be exploring together is that generosity flows from our joy that comes from salvation. Generosity flows from our joy that comes from salvation. Connected with this reality of the collection of what was going on and why they were collecting money and sending it to other churches, specifically the church in Jerusalem, is that when somebody decided to follow Jesus, they left everything behind. It usually meant poverty in some way. It usually meant that if they had some kind of specific job or trade or that kind of thing, usually in their community, it might have gotten them blackballed, or where people might not do business with you, or they might, there was just animosity there, especially in Jerusalem, where you had this tension between the traditional Jews who didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah that was to come, and the believers who did believe that Jesus was the Savior that God had promised to the Jews. And so there was this tension there, and we find out in the book of Acts that when people joined the church, they would literally sell everything that they owned and contribute it to the church, and they lived communally together and shared in each other's needs, made sure that everybody was clothed, taken care of, fed, had doctor care, all the things, and that the church itself was taking care of all of those needs. As time progressed, they needed help with that endeavor, and they needed monies to make sure that that ministry in Jerusalem would continue. And so Paul and his team, as they were on their journey, would collect money to send back to the church in Jerusalem so that they could all be partnering together and supporting one another, even the folks who were far west compared with where Jerusalem was, where the church started. And so in this section, Paul is really advocating for this value of generosity. So I have an illustration. You can go, I think, two slides from now. Maybe. Should be a sack of groceries. There we go. So this reminds me of when I was just starting out in college. My friend Jeremiah was a leader in our church over the youth group specifically, and he had started this prayer group at his home at Clackamas Trails Apartments in Clackamas, Oregon, and specifically for the youth guys. And we met together and we prayed together, and my faith really grew in a way that was unparalleled up until that point. I would bring my guitar because that's my typical contribution to things is music, and so I would lead a few songs and we would pray together, and we would share in each other's burdens about what was going on in each other's lives, and we wouldn't just pray pray, but we would pray for each other and different things. And one time, it was probably at a point in the summer after this had all started, where Jeremiah's wife shared in our group and said, you know, I don't know how we're going to make groceries this month. They were working a couple of jobs, making sure that their kids were well fed, had three or four kids by that point. And this touched my heart because I grew up in a very similar kind of work environment socioeconomically, where my parents and me, we didn't have very much. My sister didn't have very much, and we grew up poor, on the very, very low end of middle class, if not poverty level, just enough to not qualify for food stamps at the time. And so this touched my heart because I'm like, man, you guys have just been investing in us kids, us young adults at that point. And so I was moved to say, like, so what do you need? Like, what's your grocery list? Because I don't know what kids eat. I was 18 years old. I had my mind elsewhere in the world and things. And so with the help of my parents, we bought them groceries and dropped it off, I think, on their doorstep, where I delivered it to them. And my mom had included a note in there that said, we've been there too. And I don't say that or give this example to say, look at me, guys, I'm so great. I use that as an example because in the family of faith, we're supposed to help each other. If one of us is experiencing hardship, then we need to help provide for that person. We need to help, like, come alongside them and make sure that they get both the help that they need then, and also help so that they could be sustained beyond just that point. So often, though, in the church, not necessarily our church, but just church generally speaking, is that oftentimes those of us who have been saved for a while, sometimes we're not as quick to respond. Sometimes we're not as sensitive to that moment. And maybe we might think that, oh, well, somebody else will take care of it. Maybe if we just get them, like, hooked up to food stamps, we'll be fine. We'll talk way more about that in just a moment. But my point is that the church that Paul was speaking to, he needed to remind these affluent people in Corinth who were doing actually pretty good that they needed to practice generosity, that they needed to employ this value that should be inherent in the body of Christ in everything that they did, especially this collection that was being collected for the church in Jerusalem. Now, I want you to hear me really quick before we get into the word today. This series on generosity is not some formula for giving. This is not some request that I'm making to you to say, please give more to the church, although we do have needs, and we can talk more about that at council meeting on Thursday. This is not that. This is not an appeal to say, if you give this and if you do that, then you will be blessed. That's not this part of the series. What this is it's reinforcing the idea that, friends, we should be a generous people. Regardless of the outcome, because Jesus was generous to us. And I'm getting ahead of myself again. So, without further ado, please turn in your Bibles with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, beginning in verse 1. Paul, speaking to the church in Corinth, said, And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us, meaning his team, for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. So we urged Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. We'll stop there. Oh, guys, the next few weeks are going to be awesome. It's going to be so much fun. The first thing we learn in our passage today is that the grace of giving generously shares what God has given. The grace of giving generously shares what God has given. I love how in introducing the Macedonian churches to this conversation, he points out, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. What grace? Well, first, is that they even have a faith in Jesus. That these people, this grace, this undeserved gift, these non-Jews who are not a part of the original covenant, Paul, in his revealing of this new covenant, is saying, there's a Macedonian church. There are believers to the north of you who are on fire for the Lord. And they have received grace. Another area of how this is grace and how that is applied is that in the midst of what he described as their severe trial and extreme poverty, it was bad news bears for the Macedonians. Instead of what we might think that they would experience of being downtrodden and just kind of pummeled into the dirt because of this extreme poverty and extreme trial and all of that. Instead, what we see, though, is something completely different. They have an overflowing joy. They have a rich generosity that overflows from their experience. That through it all, their experience of God's grace was so good in that hard place that they were then able to respond in faith and say, can we help? They had generously been given this grace by the Lord to participate in salvation. And they saw themselves as a part of the bigger family and wanted to help. How often it is, I don't know about your experience, but as someone who grew up in poor, humble beginnings, sometimes it feels more often than not always, but sometimes it's the poorest among us who are the most generous. I'm not trying to indict those of us who have more. I'm just saying that that tends to be a dynamic that's at work within culture and in life for some reason. Once upon a time, when I was in band in high school, I thought because I was a poor kid and didn't know any better, I was like, hey, I got to sell these candy bars to raise money for this trip that we're supposed to go on. I'm going to go to Mount Scott. I'm going to go to the place where it's the richest place. All these people, they got all these big houses and all this everything. That was the worst sales ever that I had ever experienced. Then I went to, Then I went to the Foster Powell area, which is a pretty depressed area in Portland, and I sold the whole box. It was amazing. Now, maybe they just felt pity on somebody who was really, I was not a good salesperson back then. But let me tell you, if you needed help in Portland, unfortunately, in my experience, you didn't always go to the richest person. You go to the people who have this shared life experience among you. And so in an interesting turn of events, here are the Macedonian people, where they, as Paul describes them, they're facing trials. They're extremely poor, similar to the church in Jerusalem, where the church in Jerusalem, those believers were experiencing incredible trials by the religious leaders, and they were extremely poor, although everyone's needs were met. And what we see from these people is rich generosity. How amazing is that? Now, this makes me think of this idea of generosity flowing from our joy that comes from salvation. It makes me think of you and me as though we were a water pitcher. Follow me on this. So, got a picture up on the screen where it's some party and there's a water dispenser, whatever they call that. There's an official name for it. Doesn't matter. Point is, it's a water pitcher. It's got all this water in it. And then there's some cups nearby. Now, what do you think that water pitcher is there for? It's to drink. It's to share the contents of what's inside the water pitcher, right? Now, how many of you, show of hands, maybe you're not so proud of this kind of a moment, but you've experienced this before, where if you have a water bottle and you fill it with water, and maybe you take one drink out of it, but you leave it in your car for like 3 or 4 weeks because you're lazy, like me, what does it smell like in there? Not good. It's not good, because that stagnant water that's just in there has not been poured out or, you know, released. My goodness, I need to throw that away. Okay. Thank you. I'm here all week. So, train of thought, water pitcher. Okay. If you were to leave, like let's say you planned a party and you had one of these water pitchers around and you just left the water in there, eventually there's going to be some bacteria that grows in there and it's not going to be good water anymore to drink, right? But when you are actively in the process of filling and pouring out and being filled and pouring out, the water is fresh, right? Okay, now I would submit to you within this illustration that grace that we have received by faith in Jesus, we have had the water inside of us transformed by God's grace through faith. But that grace is not meant to be hoarded. It's not meant to just stay there. That grace that you and I have received by faith and faith alone, it's meant to be shared with other people. It's meant to be given out. And there are people, friends, who have experienced things like you have experienced things in your life, who need to hear your testimony. Because how God's grace has met you and your brokenness, that can transform lives just by you sharing what the Lord has done in your life. Now, for these people, the literal grace that's being talked about is money that God has provided for them to be able to share with the Macedonians, but it was beyond what Paul was even expecting. He's like, well, maybe it might be this much, but it actually exceeded his expectations. How much more for you and I? That it for us pouring out from our reserve of what God has given to us and how he has transformed our lives when we share that with other people, because generosity flows from our joy that comes from salvation. It's not a drudgery. It's not a compulsion. It's something that we freely do. So, the second thing I see in our passage is that grace of giving, it enables us to give ourselves completely to God and his will. So in verse 5, it says about the Macedonians, it says, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. It's an interesting pattern that in them wanting to be generous, of them wanting to give of themselves, the order that it happened, first things first, they yielded their lives to the Lord. They gave themselves to the Lord. And then Paul submits to the Corinthians that it was the will of God that they also gave themselves to Paul and his team, making themselves available to what they needed. What does the church need? Okay, let me write that check out. Let me do that. How can we help? How can we participate in this work that the Lord's people need to be sustained? And this makes me think of a posture. We've talked about posture a lot. I'm a posture guy. I love posture because it says so much. So up on the screen, we have this this picture of somebody with open hands. And open hands can mean a lot of different things, especially as we practice worship and life and different things with open hands. One of the things that it can mean is a yielded surrender, where when you have open hands, you're not trying to control the thing that you're giving. You're letting it just kind of freely flow. You're not trying to manipulate it to be a certain way, to have a certain outcome, but you're just letting it happen as the Lord works through you. Contrast to clenched hands. Clenched hands in this illustration, in this scenario, is me trying to control the thing. I know that people need help, but I want to make sure that they use it right. I want to make sure that that person on the corner who's saying they need just a few cents, or they come by my shop, or they come by my thing, and they say, I just need a few dollars to get a room over here. I want to make sure that they actually spend it on that and not on any manner of other things that people can spend money on, right? Or how about this? I'm so tight-fisted, I want to say, you should get a job. Even though they don't have an address, and that's a whole other thing that they have to experience. My point is this. What Paul is illustrating by referencing the Macedonian church at that time is that for the Macedonians, they did not have this posture. They were not closed off to this need. They said, Lord, what do you need me to do? You've already given me this grace. You've provided everything I need for today. How can I help? It was not, should I? Maybe. I don't think I should do that. It was, God, freely flow through me so that you can help your people through this cracked pot of an instrument. And so the grace of giving, this thing that Paul uses to describe what the Macedonians were given by the Lord, is that this enabled them to give themselves completely to God and his will. They didn't hold anything back. And this makes me wonder for you and for me. I'm not just pointing the finger at you. I got the thumb pointed back at me. I wonder for you and for me, have we completely given ourselves to the Lord or not? And if not, why not? Because maybe I did that way back when. Maybe I did that 10 plus years ago. Maybe I did that yesterday. Maybe I need to do it fresh today. Have I given myself completely to the Lord, saying, "Your will be done"? I'm not going to control it. I'm not going to try to manipulate it. I'm just going to let it happen. God, how you want. Is that my posture? Is that your posture? I would submit to you that Paul would advocate for this kind of attitude to seek first the Lord and his righteousness, just like Jesus said, and all the things will be added to you so that you will be provided for. But friends, first seek the Lord and his will. And so then if people come to you and say, "Hey, I've observed that you have this gift or this ability or this grace that God has given you. Would you be willing to share that with God's people, or would you be willing to share that in ministry?" Instead of closing your fists and being like, "Oh, I don't know," try opening up those hands and let the Lord flow through you. The third thing that I see in our passage is that the grace of giving is a complete expression of our faith. It's a complete expression of our faith. So Paul, I don't know if you caught up. We're about to enter a section where Paul is going to get really snarky and really sassy with the Corinthians, and he's going to kind of use some creative wording to kind of influence them to say, like, "Hey, guys, maybe you should think about this." Did you catch that on, I believe it was verse 7. So, it's the will of God. They urge Titus to complete this act of grace on your part. And then in verse 7 it says, "But you, since you excel," you do really great in this, "in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge." He's really stroking their ego, you guys. "In complete earnestness, and in the love that we have kindled in you." And then he drives it home. See that you also excel in this grace of giving. Oh, Paul, man, he's doing so much good. So in all these things that he mentions, faith, speech, knowledge, earnestness, love, you could argue that those are amazing expressions of our faith, are they not? I mean, even Paul in 1 Corinthians, he says, the greatest gift that you can have is love. And then he talks about how these things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these are love. Paul's a love guy. He loves love. And yet, he says, and by the way, make sure that you excel in the grace of giving. This makes me think of how it used to be in days gone by that the church was the place that people would go to when they needed help. That the church was a place where there were services provided, where if you needed help and you were down on your luck, you could go and get help. Now, I understand, especially as the pastor of our church, we don't have a ton of resources. And yet, there are some people who still come by asking for help from our church. But there used to be a time about 100 years ago when people would go to the church and say, "I'm down on my luck. I don't have a job, or I got just this little bit. Do you have any food? Do you have anything that could help me and my family be sustained?" And then the church would help minister those practical needs to those people. Now, over the years, there became almost this contrast in Protestant churches, where there were people who would say, well, we want to present a full gospel to people, not what they categorized as a social gospel. Now, because you might be completely new to all of this, that's okay. This is an old debate, as old as our denomination's been around, and older, is that there became this debate between churches saying, like, well, we really need to minister to the practical needs of people, their actual physical, tangible needs. And then, on the other side of it, people said, but their spiritual needs, we need to minister their spiritual needs. We need to make sure they're saved. We need to make sure they're filled with the Holy Spirit. We need to make sure that we have all these things figured out. And then there became kind of this war between the two. So much so that even our tribe, one of the reasons we did not go through with the merger to join the United Methodist Church, we decided, you guys are doing great at the social thing, but you're kind of doing that too much. You're really underemphasizing the spiritual side of things. And so we formed as a group because of the conviction that we needed to minister to the spiritual part of a person. I would submit to you, because it's what Paul says, and it's what the Bible would submit to us, is that it's not, those two different ideas are not meant to be at war with each other. The gospel should be both the full gospel presentation and a social gospel working together in harmony, so that you and I could express our faith in the good news that Jesus Christ, the one Son of the one true God, came and died for you and me so we could be rescued out of our sin and out of our shame, and we can be able to live this life for him by his grace through faith, filled with the Holy Spirit, empowered for life and godliness. And as a expression of that, we can care for the broken and the hurting in our community. Friends, the church, as we progress together, you and me, as we continue on in this life in our community, we need to be a church that is generous, practicing that grace of giving, because that generosity flows from our joy, that excitement, that exuberance that comes because we are saved. Why do we do the things to serve the community? Because Jesus saved me. Why would we start a soup kitchen if we ever did that kind of thing? It's not just because those people need soup and because we make a mean chili every now and then. It's not that reason. It's because Jesus died for you and me. It's because there is life to be found in Jesus. And man, if we could get that together, what a force to be reckoned with. I'm so passionate about it right now because, friends, in our community, there are brothers and sisters of yours and mine who influenced the vote on the homeless shelter to be voted down. Now, wherever you land on that side of the debate, there's a lot to be ironed out with it, and I'm glad they're going to continue those discussions. But my point is, friends, the church should be the first to be generous, not the world. So, the grace of giving is a complete expression of our faith, because Jesus was generous to us when we didn't deserve it. When we were even enemies with the Lord, he died for the ungodly and provided a way where there was no way for us to be reconciled to the Father. How much more should you and I, when we do these things in our life, and it doesn't have to be grand, it doesn't have to be extravagant necessarily in what it shows everybody else. It could be as simple as, hey, can I get you a cup of coffee? It could be as simple as just smiling at your neighbor who you don't really like, but he's your neighbor or she's your neighbor, and all of that. Like, it could be a simple kind of thing. It could be participating in whatever initiatives our church or the church in Florence at large is doing to help serve our community. It can be anything on that strata and more, because the point is not exactly what it is, it's that it's what it does. It expresses our faith. And let our testimony be that we are a generous people. I already know from all those who file through our doors periodically throughout the year that people come to our church and they say, boy, those people are a loving church. They're a good church. They're so warm and inviting and welcoming. Like the Corinthians, we need to still be reminded, whether we like it or not, whether we want to take the position or not, that we need to excel also in being generous. As the worship team comes up, let's go ahead and pray. Father, I thank you so much for your grace and kindness towards us, and that your kindness has led us to repentance and to see clearly how great you are and how not great I am. But by your grace, you loved me so much that you saved me, and you saved my friends and my family here in this place and beyond, my brothers and sisters in Jesus. God, thank you for your grace. And I thank you for the gift that you gave us, that is the act of giving. God, help us to excel in giving, to being generous. Not just willy-nilly, not just random, but God, following your spirit as you speak, as you reveal, that we would respond with like action, and that we would respond in a way, God, that would say, God, I heard you. I know that you brought this need to my attention, and now I'm going to act because you have been so good to me. So God, as we sing this last song, as we declare your greatness, God, would you bring about ideas in our hearts and in our lives to figure out how we can be more generous and more practicing that grace of giving, like Paul encouraged the church in Corinth to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with us as we close?
Love you, Lord, with all my heart. You've given me a brand new start, and I just want to sing this song to you. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. My heart and soul are praising hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Thank you for responding to the Lord with your thanksgiving in your hearts and through your praise. As we go from this place, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Amen. Have a great week.